Good morning to our Anointed Ground Church family and our listening audience. I am Co-Pastor Reeves of Anointed Ground Church, and I'm here to give the Perfecting Class a lesson for today. Today is April 18, 2021, and the title of our lesson is Dead to Sin, Alive in Christ. And the lesson text comes from Romans chapter 6, verses 1 through 14, and our related scriptures are 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 12 through 23, and Colossians chapter 3, verses 1 through 11. And our golden text for the day reads as follows: Likewise, reckon ye also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. And that comes from Romans chapter 6, verse 11. So let us pray before we get into the lesson today. Father, we truly say thank you for this lesson. And Father, we ask the Holy Spirit to come in a mighty way and to be able to teach this lesson through me. So Father, I truly give you all praise, glory, and honor for this lesson today. And we pray that it will come up a hundredfold in the lives of your people. So we truly thank you for this opportunity to be able to teach this lesson today and for your people to be able to hear and apply in their lives. So we love you and we give you free course in this lesson today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now today's aim is, for the facts, to study Paul's teaching that Christians are to be dead to sin and alive to righteousness. And the principle is to understand that Christ delivers us from the power of sin in our lives. And the application is to live free from the bondage of sin and active obedience to God. Now I'd like to read all of our scripture lesson text before we begin the lesson, and it starts at Romans chapter 6, verse 1. What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? Know ye not that so many of us were baptized into Jesus Christ, were baptized into his death? Therefore we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also shall walk in newness of life. For if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall be also in the likeness of his resurrection. Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. For he that is dead is freed from sin. Now if we be dead with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him, knowing that Christ, being raised from the dead, dieth no more. Death hath no more dominion over him. For in that he died unto sin once, but in that he liveth unto God. Likewise, reckon ye also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body, that you should obey it in the lusts thereof. Neither yield ye your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourselves unto God as those that are alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness unto God. For sin shall not have dominion over you, for ye are not under the law, but under grace. So for our lesson today, dead to sin, alive in Christ. Now with Jesus coming into this world and suffering and dying and rising from the dead, God's grace was made available to overcome the problem of sin. Remember that the Bible says that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. God's grace covers every sin that people, if they would ask God for a repentant heart, God's grace will cover those sins. This indeed does not give you a license to continue in sin, or a desire to want to sin more just because God gives grace and mercy. As a people, we should be more grateful for God's abundant grace, and also we should grow into abundant righteousness. We should want to have a desire to live righteously because of what God did for us by providing grace for the covering of all of our sins. Now, since we are justified freely by God's grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, Paul in our lesson had to get some things in order because some people were distorting the concept of salvation through grace. Some were doing all different kinds of things because they knew that God's grace would cover their sins. In Paul's time, there were false teachers that were more forceful to the Gentiles about keeping the Mosaic law, demanding them of circumcision as a means of salvation. They were legalists, and they were saying that grace wasn't sufficient. They were saying grace is an insufficient thing without works. They were saying that works had to be added to what Christ had already done in order to be saved. And we know that is not correct. It's not by your works. It's about what Jesus Christ has done for each one of us. Now, there was another group of people called the Antinomians. They were literally anti-law people. They wanted to cast aside all moral restraints. They were teaching that Christians could do anything they pleased. They could sin as much as they wanted to because God was going to forgive them. They were taking grace for granted. So we can find out Paul had his hands full of what he was trying to teach to the people. Their views were counterproductive of living a godly life. Paul rejected their view of the Christian faith in his opening of our lesson today. And as we look at verses 1 and 2 of Romans chapter 6, verses 1 and 2, let's see what Paul said, because he was kind of upset. Paul said, "What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound?" Look what Paul said in verse 2. He said, "God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein?" Paul was extremely upset about how they were thinking. They're thinking, the more sin you do, the more grace you'll get. Wow. You never know how people are thinking. And this is what Paul was saying to them. Christians, you should be dead to sin. When you accepted Jesus Christ in your life, you put sin to death. And if you truly repented in your life, you know God is going to give you the grace if you truly repented. Now, that will put you on a path with a goal to resist temptation and live above sin. Now, those people that were wanting to sin because they thought they were going to get more grace, it wasn't going to happen like that. Paul is letting them know you have to be thankful for the grace of God. And you are to do everything possible to resist the temptation to sin. Being dead to sin does not mean that believers cannot or will not ever sin again, but their ultimate goal is not to intentionally sin, but to resist the temptation to sin always. We know that people have a sinful nature and they have to crucify the flesh every day in order to be able to stay on the path of righteousness. Because we know that temptation is all around us. You can't even cut the TV on without something tempting, I don't care if it's trying to get you to eat something when you're not supposed to be eating, or some sexual half-dressed person going across the screen on the TV or whatever. You know, it's just awful. The temptation, underwear commercials on TV, it's just has a lot of temptation that's all around us constantly. But you know what? God, he gave us a scripture to remember that he promised us that with every temptation, he would make a way of escape. Now, the issue is that some people see the way of escape, they hear the way of escape, but they choose not to take it. That is when all the problems start, because God kept his promise. He said with every temptation, he would make that way of escape. So you have to choose when that way of escape comes and temptation is there. You got to run, you got to flee, you got to turn, you got to do something in order to be able to get away because God has made a way of escape. Now let's look what Paul says in verses 3 and 4. Paul is addressing baptism in verses 3 and 4. He is reminding us that Christian baptism is very important. It is symbolic to the conversion of people. Paul had never visited the Church of Rome, but he knew that they were baptized believers. And since baptism was commanded by Christ in the Great Commission in Matthew chapter 28 verses 19 through 20 and Mark chapter 16 verses 15 and 16, Paul was letting them know how important baptism to a Christian is. Paul says in verse 3, "Know ye not that so many of us as were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into his death?" And verse 4, "Therefore we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in the newness of life. By faith we are brought into Christ's body when we turn from sin and put our trust in him and his saving work of redemption." Something very important for us to remember is this: without repentance, true repentance, and a profession of that faith, baptism is a meaningless ritual. Some people just go through the motions of being baptized. If they have not truly repented of their sin, they're just going through the ritual of going down in the water and coming up saying that they have been baptized. It takes true repentance and faith by the individual being baptized, along with a converted heart and life and changes in their life by the power of God's Spirit. Baptism is a rite to the passage from the old dominion of sin into the new dominion of righteousness. The symbolic value of water baptism is twofold. First, it displays what happened to Christ. He died on the cross, he was buried in the tomb, and he arose on the third day. Secondly, it displays what happened to us. We died to sin, were buried with him by baptism into death, and were raised to walk in a newness of life. So the twofold of the water baptism is good. And we truly thank God for water baptism because it's an outward display showing that something inwardly has happened in your life. Now look what Paul says in verses 5 and 6. He says, "For if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall be also in the likeness of his resurrection. Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin." Now, when you crucify that old nature, that old man, when sin is destroyed, and when it says you will not serve sin if you crucify that old man. And to serve sin means to commit sin. It also means to continue to practice sin. We as born again believers and baptized, washed saints should not be committing sin. For you have been crucified, your body has been crucified, and sin has been destroyed. So you shouldn't be continuing to practice sin and doing all of those kinds of things. So for verse 7, it says, "For he that is dead is freed from sin." If you're freed from sin, that means you're not alive to sin. You're not practicing sin. You're not wanting to have fun in sin. You're not looking for a way to sin. You're not planning on how to sin. Because remember, you are dead to sin. And remember what the scripture says, that if you continue to practice sin and you do sin, and you're supposed to be dead to sin, it says that sin will have dominion over you. So you don't want it to have dominion over you because you have been freed from sin. And remember that sin has pleasure for a season, but the end of it is death. Now in verse 8, Paul is saying, now if we be dead with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him, knowing that Christ, being raised from the dead, dieth no more. Death hath no more dominion over him. For in that he died unto sin once, but in that he liveth unto God. Now when Jesus was raised from the dead, he defeated the grave. He was no longer subject to pain and death. And as believers arise from the water of baptism, they are to live a new life, having died to a life of sin, and are now free to live in obedience to God. Because of Christ, sin no longer has control over us. Christians are no longer slaves to sin. Now, if you find yourself being enslaved and entangled in sin again, you truly have to repent, and you have to be sincere and have a change in your heart and ask the Lord for forgiveness to be able to help you to remove that sin from your life. You have to do some things. You have to shut all the doors and the windows to sin. You cannot even leave a little crack open for Satan to come in. Because if you leave a little crack open, Satan will come in and take over. That means you might have to give up some relationships, turn off some phone calls, leave some people behind, because if they're going to lead you back into sin or lead you back into old habits, you have to make some quality decisions. You might even have to, if you have some habits with the computer, if the computer is going to lead you back into sin, you might have to cut back on your usage of the computer, not using it if it's going to lead you back into sin. Being dead to sin means you are no longer controlled by an old sinful impulses that you used to do before you got saved. When you were out there in the world, your sinful impulses would make you want to go and do things and force you to do things. Now you should have a new focus. You have been dead to sin. Now your new focus is that you're going to use your body and the way to be able to be pleasing to Almighty God. Now the enemy would love to have you back after you have given your life to Christ. And you can't never go back once you've given your life to him, because he has cleaned you up. He has delivered you from things that you were doing in the world. So you cannot go back to the old habits. Look at what Paul says in verse 9, knowing that Christ, being raised from the dead, dieth no more. Death hath no more dominion over him. For in that he died unto sin once, but in that he liveth unto God. Likewise, reckon ye also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ, our Lord. We're supposed to be alive to Christ. We are a new creature. All old things are passed away and everything becomes new. So we are new. So we're alive unto God. We should be fiery for him and to do the things that Jesus Christ wants us to do. And in verse 12, it says, let not your sin therefore reign in your mortal body, that you should obey it in the lust thereof. And verse 13 says, neither yield ye your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourselves unto God as those that are alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness unto God. Now that is simply saying, give your body over to God to be used for his purposes and his will. And that your body now is not going to be with that old nature. It's with the new nature. It's with the new path on the king for the kingdom of God. Before, when you were saved, you were doing all these unrighteous things. You were serving sin. You were living and following what the devil told you to do. But now you're a new person. You've been baptized, water baptized, Holy Ghost filled, and you can't go back. You got to stay on the righteous path. You are now on a mission of righteousness, of righteous living, and yielding your instruments of righteousness to the glory of God and the building of his kingdom, taking that energy and directing it towards things that will upbuild God's kingdom and his people. You have to have that passion, have that zeal, and want to do a great work for Almighty God. And there is a great work that has to be done. Even during this time of the pandemic, there is a great work that still has to be done. There are still people out there that never heard about Jesus Christ and are on their way to hell. So we as baptized Christians and those that have been saved should be still trying to get those that have not heard about Jesus Christ saved. In our families, be able to help them to get onto the right path of righteousness. So there is a great work still to be done, even during this pandemic. So now the scripture tells us that we should not be using our body in any way in the lust thereof, our instruments of our body, in unrighteousness and sin. We are now to be alive to God, dead to sin. So this lesson is very important, because during this season that we're in now, when we're not meeting together, the enemy is trying to get some people to try to go back into the old way. Go back to the old habits, the old nature, the old way of thinking, remembering, using their members and the instruments of their body in ways that God forbids. So people are trying to go back and do those things that they've been brought out. And then you think about it, is, you know, there's a verse that talks about people going back like a dog going back to its vomit and the folly of things. This is no time to be trying to go back. Like the word that I gave before, Jesus is on his way. So you've got to stay on the path of righteousness. Stay on the path of holiness, because sin is just going to take you down. Dead, you got to be dead to sin, alive to Christ. So this lesson is very important during the times that we're living in. So Paul was pleading to the people. He was telling them about baptism. He was telling them how they should live and not to have sin have dominion over them. And as I get ready to close, I think about the lesson. Look at verse 14. It says, "For sin shall not have dominion over you, for ye are not under the law, but you are under grace." So we're not under the bondage of law, but because of God's grace and his mercy and everything that Jesus Christ has done for us, we love him. And we want to be able to show him that we love him by the way that we live and our gratitude in what all that he has done for us. So Paul is saying in this lesson, sin, be dead to sin and be alive to Christ. The question that Paul asked today, he says, shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? You want to continue to have sin and do sinful things because of grace abounding? Paul said, God forbid. And we can say that today, God forbid. So I thank you for listening to the lesson today. And just remember this, as we go forth into our lessons that will be coming up for it, just remember this. We as Christians, we have to be dead to sin, alive in Christ. So ask yourself, where are you? Are you dead to sin? Or is sin alive in your life? Because our lesson tells us today that we have to be dead to sin and alive in Christ. So we truly thank God for the word today, and we pray that you have a wonderful day as you continue to go forth in this day, the Lord's day. May God continue to bless and keep each of you. We love you. Thank you.